seek your kingdom and righteousness. Lord, we seek your kingdom and righteousness. Lord, we seek your kingdom and righteousness. Above all else, above all else, above all else, Lord, above all else, we seek your kingdom and righteousness. Lord, we seek your kingdom and righteousness. We seek your kingdom and righteousness.
As we're just singing, wave your arms to the Lord just as a wave offering. Present yourself. Present yourself before the Lord. And with your whole heart, we're going to sing, Lord, we seek your kingdom. Lord, we seek your righteousness above all else.
We seek your kingdom. Your righteousness, we seek your kingdom and righteousness. We seek your kingdom and righteousness. We seek your kingdom and righteousness, Lord. Your righteousness, your righteousness, the Lord our righteousness, your righteousness, your righteousness, Lord, your kingdom and righteousness. We seek 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 your and righteousness.
For surely yours is an everlasting kingdom, a dominion that has no end. All others will fade and vanish, but yours alone will stand to the end, Father.
So we seek your kingdom and righteousness. We seek your and righteousness. We seek your kingdom 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 and
righteousness. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, everybody in this place can touch heaven right now. There doesn't have to be one person left out, not one person left out. You just lift your hands to the Father. You just say, Lord, I receive, I receive, I receive, I receive, I receive the blood of Jesus Christ. I receive this perfect gift. Lord, I receive all of heaven. I receive the Holy Ghost. I tell you, you can go where you've gone in God and a greater place right now. He's only looking for you to just yield yourself to Him just enough that He can open up and pour out His Holy Spirit upon you. Yeah. It's not hard. You don't have to get all distraught about it and look like you're trying to wrestle something down. You can just lift up your voice to Him and thank Him and just receive. And just receive. Just receive. Don't stay where you're at. Don't stay with where you're at. There's some of you, you're just kind of staying where you're at. You don't want to stay where you're at. Eye has not seen and ear has not heard the things that the Lord has prepared for those that love Him. They have not seen. They have not heard. We don't want anybody in this place that hasn't seen or hasn't heard, because they're revealed to us by the Spirit. All of the things of the Spirit are revealed to us by the Spirit. And to understand and comprehend the things of God, you have to stay over in the realms of the Spirit. Because you can't comprehend them, you can't receive them outside of that. Outside. There's so many people that haven't seen, they haven't heard, they don't know. He's there in the morning when you rise up. He's there in the afternoon when you've been busy doing what you need to get done. He's right there all day long. He's there in the middle of the night. All you have to say is, fill me up, oh Lord. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. I'm desperate. Lord, I've tasted and I've seen, and I don't want to live another moment with what I've tasted and seen without it. I don't want to be without you a moment, oh Lord. Without your glory, without your presence, without your anointing. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Elevo, elevo, mariachkinela. Receive. Receive the Spirit. Shibele kuchela. Shila takara. Bele sote. Oh, the glory of heaven's in this place. The glory of heaven's in this place. He's right here. He's right near you anytime. He's just looking for you to say, fill me up, Lord. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. I want more of you, Jesus. God's not looking for golden vessels. He's not looking for silver vessels. He's looking for yielded vessels. He's looking for those that will just yield themselves to Him. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus. Lord Jesus, supreme, risote. Oh, hallelujah. Looking for you to pay the price for Him. He's just looking for you to yield to Him. He's not looking for your works. He's looking for what He's done on Calvary's cross and for you to receive. Receive what He has done. When He rose from the dead, He came to the disciples. He appeared to them in the room and He breathed on them and He said, receive. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. The toughest job He gave them was go wait for the promise. Go wait. That's a hard job for you to do. Just go wait for the promise, He said. But He already blew on them and said, receive. It's that simple. That simple. The things in God are that simple. Just receive. Just receive what He's done. It's simple. It's easy. And the reason. reason it's so important for you to receive, because I know we got a few people here tonight that they, you haven't come into that place. You know, and the Lord is so good. He'll back up and he brings people along because he loves you so much. Every person in this place, Father, loves you. He loves you. And his desire is to see you in the realms of heaven all the time and for eternity. All the time and for eternity. All the time. Whew. You know, and I'm going to read that. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Why? Because he wants to reveal the deep things of the Father to you. He wants to impart the deep things of heaven to you tonight. He wants to take you over to the realms of glory and reveal to you the deep things of the Father. Glory. Holy Shayla. For what man knows the things of man save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world. Amen. Amen, people. We've not received the spirit of the world. We've come out from among them. We've separated ourselves, says the Lord. And then he'll be a father to you. If you're holding on to the world, he's not your father. I'm sorry. You can't serve two masters. You either love the one or hate the other. You can't serve the Father and you can't serve Satan at the same time. And Satan is the father of the world. He's the spirit of darkness that rules the children of disobedience. Where the real disobedience is those that have backslide and turned their back on God. The children of disobedience. We've not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given unto us of God. The Spirit reveals the things that are freely given unto us of God. They're revealed to us, those things, those deep things, those great riches, the great riches and eyes that man can't comprehend, eyes not seen, ears not heard, man can't comprehend, but it is revealed by the Spirit. It's a spirit walk. You can't come in here tonight and hear unless you're flowing in the Holy Ghost. You can't receive. There can't be that impartation that you need, you desperately need, unless you receive it by the Spirit. Which things also we speak in the words which man wisdom, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. But the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit. Over here in the natural mind, cannot receive the things of the Spirit. Cannot receive the things of the Spirit, for they are foolishness to the natural man. Foolishness to the natural man. The natural man doesn't get it. But oh, when you've tasted and you've seen, when you've touched that glory, when that revelation has come to you and been imparted to you, when you're captivated by his presence because you just said, here I am, Lord. I want all that you have. I want everything moved out of the way. And I just want you, Father. Holy Spirit, come and baptize me afresh in the fire of your Holy Spirit. Come baptize me afresh, oh God. It's not foolishness. It's the greatest glory, the greatest experience known to mankind. There is nothing on this earth that can compare to just a moment in his presence. There is no thrill. There is no riches. There to experience the love of God that he has for his children. Woo, it's glorious. Why ever be on the outside looking in? Why not come on in and taste and see all the time? Oh, glory, hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, I heard a couple of weeks ago, I heard so loudly the Lord speak in a service one night, just as we were getting ready to take communion. And Lord, forgive me, I didn't get up. I mean, I felt like I was supposed to get up, but you know, it was just so beautiful what Pastor Mark was ministering. But anyway, I just heard the Lord say this. And I know the Lord wants to really take some things apart for people. And if you will listen by the Spirit tonight, you will get some breakthroughs in some areas of your life as the Holy Spirit wants to come and impart some things to you. And I tell you, it won't be like, when is church getting out? It'll be, oh, we just been here 5 minutes. What are we doing? Getting ready to go. Because see, that's in a spiritual realm. See, that's like what it is in heaven. Our loved ones have been there, but it's been like 10 minutes to them because they're so captivated by the realms of his glory and his presence that you don't want to go home. You're captivated. You're caught up in another realm. Oh, Jesus. But I heard the Father say Cain's offering won't do. Cain's offering is unacceptable. You can't come with Cain's offering. It won't do. And I wonder how many people know what Cain's offering was. Abel, he was a man that his occupation was a herdsman. And Cain, he tilled the ground. And Abel, he brought forth of the herd, the sacrifice. And God honored that sacrifice. And Cain, he brought of the ground what he had done, his occupation. And it was already very well established, the sacrifice that God would accept when this was taking place. But Cain was determined to come to God his way. Rationalizing it out. Figuring it out in his head. Why isn't this a good offering? Why isn't the offering of the grain good? Because the blood is what covered the sin. Today, through Jesus Christ, the blood is what washes away the sin and sets you completely free from the powers of darkness where Satan has no more power, no more rule, no more reign over you. He cannot touch you. He has no place in you. When the blood is applied, when the blood is there, when you're walking under the blood of Jesus Christ, when you're staying in him and allowing yourself to be kept by the power of God, there is nothing the enemy can do against you. When you're in that place, it's only if you allow. See, Satan has no power over you. It's only if you allow him to. Once you come to the blood of Jesus Christ, it's done. It's settled. He has no power. He can roar and scream and yell and kick and try every kind of thing. But if you don't give in any way, he has no power over you. None. But Cain's trying to figure it out in his head. Why isn't mine good enough? This is what I do. This is my occupation. We can look at it and we can like look at how man works it out today. Because I tell you, it's the same enemy whispering his lies today. And it's called humanism. Yeah. It's called humanism. It's called man wanting to figure it out instead of just being like Abel and doing it God's way. Man cannot get to God man's way. Man's way will not work. When man tries to bring themselves to God their way, they're just thieves and robbers trying to come up another way. The decision has been made, but it must be God's way, and it isn't our rationalizing, and it isn't our trying to figure it out. And it isn't our catering to the enemy and that people allow in their life, being all nice and sweet to them. Because God's going to deal with what's going on because he loves. He's going to tell the truth. He's not going to tiptoe around the tulips to make you happy. He's going to give you the truth so you can have life. He's going to bring the light to turn the darkness and completely away. The truth sets man free.
Yes, it
does. The truth. And Cain, he gets all angry at God. He's mad at God because God won't accept his humanistic, rational thinking of trying to figure it out. And God says, Cain, why are you angry? Why are you angry? Why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, shall you not be accepted? If you do well. Right here is so clear. Cain knew what was right. Cain knew what God required. But Cain wouldn't come God's way. Because he was determined to have it his way. We can't have it God's way in our way. If you want to be in the spiritual realm where the things of heaven are revealed to you, you must come God's way. And he says, well, if you don't do it right, then sin lies at the door. Sin lies at the door. And it's going to rule you. Sin will rule you. It will take you over and it will destroy you if you're going to come up your way. Man's way is humanism. Man's way is the enemy against God. It's not God's way. We can look in Hebrews chapter 11. And there, we can comprehend another part of this. Chapter 11, verse 4. By faith, Abel offered up unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaks. Even though Cain slew his brother, I mean that self-willed humanistic thing that is supposed to be the caring part and all, you know, you got to be loving and you got to do it this way and not, you know, despising authority, despising God's way. It literally is the way that takes to hate and murder. Because what did it do? Man's way took it all the way to murdering his brother Cain. Took the first life. That's where man's way will get you. It will get you right hooked up with the powers of darkness. Be not deceived. Don't lie to yourself. Where there's strife and there's envy, there's every evil work. This wisdom ascendeth not from above, but is earthly, devilish. It has nothing to do with the Father. It's man's way. God's way is the love of God. That love that so loved man that he gave his son, Jesus Christ, and watched him be completely tortured and mutilated. You think that that was easy for the Father to step back and watch the Word, which became flesh, the Word that was there in the beginning with God that created all things? Do you think it was easy for the Father to step back and watch the enemy have his way through the willingness of man to be so brutal till he was beaten to the place that he wasn't even recognizable? It was hard to look upon him because he was so disfigured. Isaiah says, his countenance was so disfigured by the brutality of man was easy for the Almighty God that created all things to watch. But that was love. That is love. That is love that Father stood back and allowed mankind to be so brutal to his only begotten Son, because he knew that the price had to be paid for us to be brought back into fellowship. And because his love is so great for us, he was willing to pay that price. He was willing to pay that price for us. Oh, and I tell you what, it is finished. And our works and our ability can be over if we will just step over here and receive his works and his ability. And receive them so freely by the Spirit, we never have to get caught up in our stupidity again. We never have to go about our way and do it again. So many times we're trying to dig ourselves out of the trouble we got ourselves in. And we're like, oh God, how did we get here? And he said, because you weren't listening. How did I get in this mess? A lot of people blame God. They blame God for everything. Unless it's good, for the most part. I'm not talking about his saints that know him and know every good and perfect thing comes from the Father of lights. And every evil thing comes from the powers of darkness that you opened yourself up to. And we don't listen and we get ourselves into a bind. But I tell you what, his goodness and his mercy is. Even though you got yourself there, he doesn't say, I'm going to leave you there. He's going to come and he's going to pick you up and he's going to fix it for you if you give it to him. He'll take everything that the enemy meant for bad for you and he will turn it around if you will give it to him. He's so amazing. He fixes brokenness. Bring the worst, most broken person in this place and God will make them brand new. Old things will be passed away and behold, all things will become new. I don't care where you've been. I don't care what you've done. I don't care how bad you were when you come to Jesus. He makes you a child of the King. The Creator of all things is able. He's able by the blood. He's able by the blood. He's able by the blood of Jesus Christ. The work is finished for you. Hallelujah. And we look here by faith, Abel, by faith, by faith. What is faith? Faith is believing God. Faith is believing that he is. It's believing him. We see Enoch believed him. By faith, Enoch. There's obedience all in this chapter. Through faith, the worlds were formed. Through faith, Enoch was translated because he believed God. He didn't see death, and he has a purpose and a plan to come back. He's living in his natural body, and he will come back in the last time of this dispensation. Not of this world, because this world will last forever. It's just going to go to another dispensation. It's not the first dispensation we're living in, though some people think it is. But I tell you what, this life is but a fleeting moment. It's but a moment in time for all eternity. And how we live it, if we live it for him or if we're living it for ourselves, is what we're going to reap, because what you sow is what you reap. And if you give your life to him now, you'll live with him for eternity. But if you hold on to your life now and you try to live it out for yourself, you'll have your life apart from him for eternity. And I tell you what, when that decision's made, I mean, you better know that you're making it right, because when you're gone and it's over and you breathed your last breath, there's no coming back. There's a few that's been raised from the dead, but I'll tell you, in comparison to those that die, it's a very few. It's a very few that have another chance to come back and make it right. You want to know you're doing it right. You want to know you're doing it by the Spirit. You want to know that it's the blood of Jesus Christ plus nothing, plus none of you except you yielding. That's the only thing that you can bring to God, is you yielding yourself up. You can bring nothing else to him because you have nothing to bring. All of your ability, all of your riches, all of your everything is absolutely nothing. It's only the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses it and washes it and makes you something. It makes you a child of the King. It makes you sit in heavenly places with the Almighty God. It lifts you up into the realms of glory to live out His life, for Him to live in you and through you. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice that you paid for every one of us. Now God wants to know, will you believe Him? Abel believed Him. Enoch believed Him. Noah got busy building the ark because he believed God. He believes God. All God wants you to do is believe Him. Yield yourself to Him, believe Him, and receive. He wants you to receive more than what you can ever even comprehend, and more than what you can even think about giving. He wants you to be on the receiving end of all of heaven by the Holy Ghost. He wants to reveal the deep things, the secrets of God to you by the Holy Ghost. He just wants you to receive. And if you're struggling with trying to obtain, then stop and receive. If you'll just receive more from God, you'll find yourself in the overflow. He's not looking for you to come and walk up the stairs on glass like the priests used to do and beat themselves trying to be acceptable to God, trying to find a way into God. See, it's all humanism. It's all man's way. It's all man's thinking to try to come any other way except to accept and receive. Yield yourself up and receive. It's so simple. He said, my burdens, he said, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. My burden's easy and it's light. It's light. It's easy. It's easy. It's easy to come to Him. But man wants to get over here and rationalize it out because we've lived a life of we have to think for ourselves. We've been taught that way. School taught that to us for how many years? Jump ship. Amen. Jump ship. Get into homeschooling. Do something different. Yeah. Because it's not you thinking, it's Him thinking in you. Because the natural man cannot understand the things of the Spirit. He can only understand. Man can only understand by the Spirit and yielding himself to the Spirit. And believing God, just simply believing God. It's just childlike faith. You tell a child something. A child that has a parent or a grandparent or someone that child believes. That knows, that loves them. I mean, there has to be a relationship there. But, I mean, you know, even sometimes there don't have to be a relationship because there's people that told my kids stuff and then when I found out about it, and they believed it, I thought it was hilarious. But, you know, anyway, you tell a child something and that child's going to believe what you say. They just simply, childlike faith. That's why Jesus took them and He set them in the middle of them and He said, be like the little children. Because they'll believe and they'll receive and they'll act upon it. Yep. Be like children. Yep. Yeah. In the kingdom. Yes. Don't come here with your intellect trying to figure it out because man's wisdom is foolishness to God. It can't even compare in any way. So God's not interested in what you can learn. God's not interested in what you know. He's interested in you knowing Him. He's interested in the Holy Spirit revealing Him to you so you can live it out. He knows what's good for you. You don't. How many of us tell our children that, have told our children that? Look, I know what's good for you. You don't understand it. You don't comprehend it now, but I know what's best for you. I know you touching that hot stove is going to hurt you. I know you trying to climb down those stairs and tumbling down is going to cause some problems here. I know you picking up that knife is not a good idea for you. You're only four. You're going to slice something. And we're going to be in the emergency room if we don't have the faith to pray through. I know these things aren't good for you. See, the Holy Spirit wants to reveal everything in the Spirit that's not good for you. So you'll stay out of it. So the Father doesn't have to come and dig you out of the mess. But He will. Oh, He loves us so much. If we just believe Him, if we just believe that He's the God that loves us so much, that He's not a God standing up there with a big bat waiting to clobber us in the head. So many people think that. Because humanism has taught it. They point happens. Well, God, why did you let my child come into the world suffering with such sickness? Sin brings forth death. Hello, read the word. Sin brings forth death. So there was sin somewhere that brought forth the sickness and brought forth the death. Because when you're in the light and the life of Jesus Christ, you got immortality. Already living in the light. Though we may be held up in the body for a bit, this body does not dictate. The Spirit dictates to the body. When the glory of heaven is flowing and exploding on the inside of you, it dictates to the body. Quickened by the Spirit. If this same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, the Spirit raised Christ from the dead, if it dwells in you, it will quicken your mortal body by the same Spirit. So then you live there. And then sickness and disease and all these things come out against you. You believe God. You believe what his word says. You believe. Amen. 2 Peter 2:24. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. By his stripes we were healed. Done. Settled. I don't get that. I don't have that stuff. You know, everybody around me has had different viruses, and I've gone to help. This one with fever, and this one throwing up, and this one, that, and the other. And been around them and had them, you know, breathing in my face. And those lying demons, ooh, they're yucky presence. Yep. Yeah. Yucky presence. They try to come around, and I'm like, I don't get that in Jesus' name. I don't get it in Jesus' name. That's a lie from the pit of hell. You know, I got a hold of some of these principles a long time ago, and I'm telling you, I'm like, it is time to get a hold of it all in God. All of it. The enemy try to slip around. You know, you step out in God and you try to do more things. You make a decision that you're going to do more things in God. You're going to yield yourself up. And the enemy will try to distract you, get you off course, throw things at you. Just prepare for the battle through the Spirit. And you'll go rejoicing all the way in authority. Because when you believe, when you're a child and daddy's standing behind you and a big bully's out there and something looks bad and scary, that little kid's going to be looking back there to daddy, and daddy's saying, I got it, son. That son's going to be going, we got it. You know, but the little boy goes to school and the big bully comes up to him and dad's not there, man. He's like, ah! But daddy walks up and the little kid goes, Come on. What was you saying? My daddy's right here. He's going to clean your plow. What was the enemy saying? Our father's right here. He's going to take care of it. He's already done it. It's finished. He's done it. Because you believe him. You believe your dad, man. You know your daddy loves you. I mean, Jude knows his daddy loves him. Jude could take on the world with daddy. Because daddy's going to take care of it. Nobody better mess with Jude, and boy, even more if mama's there. Because mama's going to be on it. You don't mess with the baby. He's the baby. You don't mess with Jude. Don't mess with Jude. He's confident of that, too. Even with his brothers and sisters, he's very confident of that. Can we be confident of our Father? Do we believe him? It's just simply believing and knowing the love that he has for us. It's that simple. It's that simple. And then there's no fear. There's no doubt there. Because perfect love casts out all that fear. There's no confusion. There's not a moment of fear. Fear tries to come against you. You recognize that it is a demon straight from hell, and it's not yours. Amen. And you tell it to go, because your daddy's standing right there, and he's saying it, go. And you're like, yeah, go. Amen. You have no place, you have no power, you have no authority over me, because I'm washed in the blood of the Lamb. Amen. I'm free in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. There was a song that when my dad and Uncle Charles were doing meetings together, I'd hear him sing, and we sang it through the years. Sickness has no hold on me. I'm living in heavenly places. By his stripes I'm healed. You see, I'm living in heavenly places. Living in heavenly, living in heavenly, living in heavenly places. That's where we live, in heavenly places. Living in heavenly places. Sin has no hold on me. I'm living in heavenly places. He was crucified for our sin. I can't remember exactly how that part goes, but we're living in heavenly places. When we're in heavenly places, sin doesn't come there. When you have confidence and you believe God and you know in that confidence what the Father's love for you, sin is not an issue. That takes care of sin being an issue with you, because you have received that love of God and you believe him. His seed is planted on the inside of you, and you cannot sin because he's in there. He's in there. You want no part. You want no part of the powers of darkness that bring destruction, because you have a loving Father. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. But God is so good, and he's so merciful. And you know, it makes me think of Peter. Peter, who gets the great revelation, as Jesus says, who do men think that I am? And they had all kinds of answers they were giving him. And Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, in Matthew chapter 16. And Jesus answered him and said, blessed art thou, Simon, Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father, which is in heaven. He had a great revelation from the Father. I mean, Peter was like, yeah. You know, Jesus is saying, I hit it. You know, revealed by the Father. And then Jesus starts telling them about how he's going to go to the cross. In verse 21, you know, after all of this great stuff, you know, I got to go back here and read this. And I say unto you that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Upon this revelation. People want to say that Peter was the rock that the church was built on. It wasn't a man. It was upon the revelation that the Father gave Peter. Upon the rock, Christ Jesus. He's the rock. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. The enemy can come out with all of his breathing lies, but the gates of hell cannot prevail against you. Amen. Cannot prevail against you. Hallelujah. So we go rejoicing. We don't look cast down and sad. We don't look broken and distraught. We're joyful people because we reign and rule with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Ha ha! Woo! We're on the winning side. It can look like gloom and doom, but we read the end of the book. We win. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you will bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. This is the power and the authority he has given us. Power and authority. You get to binding by the Spirit, though. By the Spirit. And following the word, saying, I don't get sickness. Sickness has no hold on me. Sin and sickness, when people get that, see, people think that sin is bad, but it's got to be covered or washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, and your sins now and in the future, and, you know, you can't help but to be a sinner, but because of the blood, lying, demonic doctrine. But sickness is okay, you're suffering for God. Sin and sickness are twins from hell. They're twins straight from hell. Righteousness and holiness are twins from heaven.
Yes.
And the redeemed of the Lord are righteous, pure, holy, saints of God. But see, if God's people perish for a lack of knowledge, and a lot of them don't want to have the knowledge. But if you know the truth, then you're set free. If you know that sin and sickness have no power over you, then you can live in the freedom that Christ Jesus paid for you. If nobody preaches it because they want a lot of people to come into their church, and it might step on somebody's toes if you tell them they're free from sin because they want to go out of here and act like the devil. They want to have two natures parted right down the middle. And on this side's black and on this side's white. And it just depends on who you're giving yourself to at the moment. I mean, what are they going to do? Split themselves in two and part goes to heaven, part goes to hell? Because sin's not entering in to his presence. So you're either redeemed or you're not redeemed. One of the two. But preachers don't want to preach it because they'll step on somebody's toes. And so they withhold the truth that will set the people free. If you have the truth, you can be free. Receive the truth, and you can live in it. Hallelujah. And I tell you what, man, if sickness comes against you and you're like, I don't get sick in Jesus' name, I'm not having sickness, I will not have sickness, and the next thing you know, you're sick, and if you're standing there throwing up, you just continue on. I don't get sick in Jesus' name. I don't have sickness. This is a lie from the enemy. Don't you get discouraged. Because, see, you know, the enemy's had this territory for a long time, and he don't like to give it up easily. And you just practicing your authority in Christ Jesus. You're just getting a hold of it. And he wants to see if he can discourage you out of it. So you go, oh, that don't work. Well, that's a valiant person. That didn't work. Oh, well, I might as well just be sick. If you have to go to the doctor and deal with stuff while you're believing God, don't come under condemnation if that's where you're at and you need to go to the doctor and the doctor tells you all that stuff that you don't want to hear, then you can really get serious with God and get some faith and push in. I know I've done it. I was prideful about not going to the doctor for so many years. I had a little bit of pride with it. Then I went to the doctor. And then I preached to the doctor. And then God healed me of everything. But, I mean, there was a fight. There was a battle in it. You just don't give up. Amen. You don't give in to sin. Amen. There'll be a fight. There'll be a battle because the enemy's trying to say, that's my territory. I once was there. I once had place there. I want it back. And you go, no, the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And if you sin, oh, hallelujah. This is the confidence that we have with the Father, that the blood of Jesus Christ will wash us away. If we repent, he'll wash away all of our sins again. If. So one time, because I got so sick of hearing the demon doctrine, you know, because we were in a place that where I didn't have any family close to me that preached and had a church, and we had to go to other churches, and we were constantly trying to find a church. I circled every if in the Bible. I'm like, people need to know what if is. If. You know, I tell you what, it'll really get your tools, you sharpen your tools in the Word when you have to go to places and they're preaching a lie. Now I know it's here. I mean, it's good for some people. I was listening to somebody over the internet the other day and they were preaching stuff and I'm like, I want to preach back to them right now. Oh boy. You know, I'm like, now I'm ready. And now I'm ready to preach. I'm like, oh, Father, send me to some of these churches. People need to hear. They might kick me out on my ear, but they need to hear. They need to at least have a chance to hear. Because we got people sitting in churches. Churches full of people going to hell because they haven't heard the truth. Here in America, they've never heard the full gospel of Jesus Christ because they've had got lying prophets standing up preaching false doctrine to them because they just want a good paycheck. I don't get a paycheck. So you can't take nothing away. It's good to be that way.
Yes, it is.
Father is my provision.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And he's a good provider. Amen. He takes care of us. He's so faithful. But over here again, back to Peter. You know, here Peter, I mean, this is powerful. Authority and I hit it. And then Jesus starts telling him how he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and raised again the third day. And then Peter takes him aside because Peter's just the strong personality in the group all the time anyway. He's always getting himself into something. He's there on the good part. He's there on the bad part. He's always there. He's there. That's the thing about it. But Peter takes him aside and starts rebuking the Lord. And starts saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto you." Humanism. Humanism. And the next thing, Jesus looks right at Peter and he says to Peter, okay, put yourself in Peter's position. "Get behind me, Satan." I don't think Pastor Mark said that directly to one person in this church. But I mean, could you imagine if the Lord Jesus stood right here tonight and looked at you right in the face and said, "Get behind me, Satan"? You'd go, "That's too much to bear." And then all the humanistic people going, "Oh, how could he say that?" Because Jesus wanted Peter to know the truth. He wanted Peter to know how to discern and not to get caught up in that humanistic idea again, not do it your way, do it by the Spirit. We get a lot of good ideas, and a lot of them are humanism. We want to hear out of our belly. We want the river to flow out of our belly, not our head. Our head will get you in trouble. Brain's not a good thing when it comes to our thinking. You want to think right here by the Spirit, because that's what the Father's saying. But God's love is so great. He says, "Get behind me, Satan, because you're an offense to me. You're offending me. For you are not concerned about the things of heaven. You don't comprehend the things of heaven. They're not the most important thing to you. This earthly, temporal, that statement you made, Peter, is earthly and temporal. And for a moment, I'm living for the eternal." So you're hooking up with the enemy. He just got revelation from heaven. Now what happened? What's he over here hooking up with the devil? And Jesus is looking right at him and saying, "Satan, get behind me." What happened? "For you savors not the things that are of God, but the things that are of man." Man is humanism. God's way is the only way. And man's way will never get there. And he wanted Peter to get it. He wanted Peter to get it. And here, you know, Peter's like strongly rebuked. And you turn around in just a few minutes, they're going to the garden to pray. And he takes Peter, James, and John with him. And he goes a little bit about a stone cast away from him. And he says, "Guys, watch and pray with me." And he comes back and he's like, he was gone an hour, because the scripture said he was gone an hour. And he comes back and they're sound asleep. He's like, "Can't you watch with me for an hour?" I mean, he just got done explaining to them that he's getting ready to go to the cross. And he walks about a stone cast away. And he tells them, he said, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful even unto death." And they go to sleep. You know, here they go blowing again. You know what's amazing, though? Jesus didn't say, "Peter, you blew it. You know, Satan, get thou behind me. Peter, you're out. Out." He didn't say it to the disciples. He came back to them the third time and said, "Sleep on, take your rest." Because the second time he comes back, he finds them sleeping. And he told them, he said, "Watch and pray lest you enter into temptation." Because, you know, Peter, he's over here, the big mouth again, when he's saying, "Lord, if everybody denies you, I will not deny you." And Jesus said, "Peter, you're going to hit your head up against the wall and you're going to realize that you can't walk it out your way. You're going to deny me three times before the cock crows. You're going to find out, Peter, that it's not by your might and not by your strength, but it's by you walking by the Spirit. You've got to learn not to walk by the Spirit sometimes. You've got to walk by the Spirit all the time." It's all the time. It's not just sometimes. It's hush that big mouth and listen. Learn to listen to the Spirit. But when you're converted, Peter, when you're converted, look at that word that he uses, when you're converted, go and strengthen the rest of the disciples. So he knew that Peter was going to stand there and deny him three times, and Jesus looked over at him. Oh, oh. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Now Peter's getting a little bit of taste of his soul being exceedingly sorrowful, but in a different manner, in a total repentance. He's getting it. But you know, the amazing thing about God is here, Jesus commissioned him to go preach immediately after you're converted. Before he even denied him, he already commissioned him. Isn't God amazing? Yes. You know, sin denies Jesus. When we allow sin, we're denying God. It's the same as, I never knew him because I'm going to come over here in the enemy's camp and play around with something that looks like a pretty package, that all it does is bring sin and death upon me and destruction. And I mean, the sad thing about it is when parents, fathers, mothers, and especially the father, because you're the door, but the mother too, because the mother's there all the time and taking care of the kids, when you open yourself up to sin, you're the door to your children. And then Satan tries to come in and wreak havoc. You want to slam all doors. You want to slam all doors. Not for only your sake, but your children. Lord, have mercy. If you can't see it for you, see it for your children. Take a hold of this by revelation of the Spirit, that you don't want to mess around and bring destruction. Because whatever spiritual atmosphere you're playing with, the enemy has full right to mess with your kids. And he'll be right over there. If you've got a problem, know your kids have it. Know it. When you realize what you've been doing, know that your kids have that same problem because you opened the door to it, because you are the way in to your kids. So it's very simple. Just receive, believe and receive the love God has for you, and it won't be an issue. When you're so in love with Jesus, how can you be in love with the devil? How? How can you want to go play in his camp when you know he's the enemy of God? So, simply, believe and receive the love God has for you. That is an explosive, red-hot love relationship. When you comprehend, when that overwhelms you, that love God has for you. When you receive that. See, man thinks what holds these things, these revelations of the Spirit, away from man are comes and begins to try to block them again once there's a revelation, is men's thinking, humanistic man's thinking, that you have to obtain to God somehow for his love to be able to receive his love. You have to do it all right. It isn't about you doing it. It's about you receiving his love, receiving, being a receiver. Amen. Coming into church or at the end of the day after a hard work day and you're like, oh God, I didn't stop and I didn't pray, or I didn't this, or I didn't that, or I looked this way, or I did this. Just say, Father, forgive me, and receive. Just receive. Just receive. Say, Father, I'm getting this. See, as long as you're coming to him, as long as you're saying, oh God, I want you, he's right there. You don't have to go and beat yourself up, not speak to God for 24 hours because you were so bad. Or get an all distraught look on your face and just go, oh, how am I going to ever get this? Why am I going to ever do this? It's me. Why me? That's the plan of the enemy. That's what he wants you in. Father just wants you to go, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, that you're here. Thank you, Father, that you've washed me in the blood of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Father, that you paid it all. I thank you, Father, that you did it all. I thank you, Father, that it's none me and all you. And you're teaching me how to walk it out. And now I want to receive right now by the Spirit. And instantly in a moment, instantly in a moment, here he is if you'll just receive. If you'll just stop being man. Stop being man. And just receive his love. Because he's working with you to bring you over into this love relationship. It is his greatest desire for you to have this relationship with him. There is nothing more important to him than you have this love relationship. This is what Jesus paid for. This is what it's all about for you to come in. And he ain't giving up on you. Ever. Till you breathe out your last breath, he's not going to give up on you. He commissioned Peter. When he knew he was going to deny him, he commissioned him to preach right after he got converted. I love that. I could just stay there. And then he said, Peter, lovest thou me more than these? Because Peter needed that. You know, there are those that walk around and they're always intimidated. Peter wasn't intimidated about nothing. He'd rather mess it all up. He'd rather sink. He'd rather whatever, because he was going to get out of the boat. He was going to be in the big middle of everything. He was going to open his mouth in the good times and the bad times when he said it right and when he said it wrong. And so he was the one that had to hit his head up against the brick wall. But the other people, you know, that, you know, there's a lot of them that just like all into themselves and all thinking about and being intimidated. And see that, I love that, because I was an intimidated person. I was so intimidated. I was so quiet, and did not like to be in front of people. And it was the last thing I wanted to do, to get up and talk to people and stand in front of people and be the one that everybody's looking at. You know, I'd rather hide in the back corner. But perfect love casts out all fear. Intimidation is fear. It's an ugly demon spirit, and I hate it. Hallelujah. When you see those ugly demon spirits, you know, I want to bring up another one. Feeling sorry for yourself is an ugly demon spirit. It's a demon spirit. You know, and people come crying to me like the feel sorry for yourself. Not, you know, they're in trouble, you know, and the tears come. But when there's a sincerity and there's tears. But I'm talking about when they're complaining and whining and feel sorry for me. If they only knew, I want to just turn them over and kick them in the behind. And go kick that devil out. That is a demon spirit from hell. Take no part of it. It's ugly. It's ugly. I'd rather somebody be a fighter than a sorry for yourself. You know, and I don't like, the fighting is an ugly demon spirit too. But it's one I can deal with a little bit better than that feel sorry for myself. Whining and complaining and complaining and whining. God hates whining and complaining. There's too much to be happy for. To whine and complain. There's too much to be thankful for. One thing, just start with I'm breathing. I'm breathing. Oh, hallelujah, I'm breathing. I'm breathing. Thank you, Jesus. It's the breath of God in me. I'm breathing. You know, if you just get thankful, you'll find yourself rejoicing all the time and you won't look all distraught and upset and unhappy because you're trying to obtain to God. You'll be joyful because he did the work. He finished it. He paid the price, not you. Not you. Not you. Guess what? Not you. He did it. He did it, and he just wants you to receive. All he wants you to do is be a yielded sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him. By what he does, not by what you did, you just receive. You just yield. Yielded position. Oh, hallelujah. How easy it is to walk with God. How easy it is to be the light to the world that's in darkness that needs the light. Not a frowning face, but the light. Not a denying Peter, but the light. Not a hypocrite, but the light. Don't you get sick of those Christians that you first meet them and they're cussing and every other kind of thing, and then you start telling them about Jesus because you know they're sinners because of the foul stuff that comes out of their mouth, and then they say, oh, I'm a Christian. It's just, right now I'm kind of giving myself to that black side, but I'll get back over here to the white side and start yielding myself a little bit more because this is these two things battling in me. And so they go into Romans chapter 7, and I'll tell you, Romans chapter 8 settled Romans chapter 7 very clearly. I don't know what anybody's problem is. It's sandwiched right in between Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 8, which is so clear. And when I read Romans chapter 7, it's clear to me anyway. Just by itself, standing alone, is completely clear. But you put 6 before it and 8 behind it. What are you talking about? You just want to be so dumb you can't breathe. You just really, really want to live for the devil is all it is. You like him. Well, you're going to live eternally with him if you like him. And God has so much more. I tell you what, the glory side is so much better than the demonic side. It's not fun over there. You're wondering where all your misery comes from. It's because you're yielding yourself over to the realm of misery. Because if you're yielding yourself over to the realm of righteousness, it doesn't matter what you go through. You're going through it with all joy. Because there's going to be trials and tribulations, and there's going to be tough things. There's going to be persecution, because if they did it to Jesus, they're going to do it to you. But you're going to go through it with all joy, because you know, you've comprehended, you've seen by the Spirit. You've had the revelation that it's for eternity and for this purpose. God has called you, and you're going to finish your course. You're going to fight the faith, and you're going to receive your crown. Because you're looking at the crown. You're looking at the glory. This present earth, this present trouble, this present distress cannot compare to the glory that is revealed in us even now. It can't compare. If you'll just get outside of you and get inside of him and let the glory flow. The glory can flow all the time. The revelation can come all the time. You know how it is, as we sit in church, it's 4 or 5 hour services, and we sit here. And I'm like, why are we standing up yet? It's only been 10 minutes. And I'm like, oh my word, it's 10:30. How could it be? How could it be? Because we've got over in the glory realm. And time has no pull on you. That's the realm of heaven. That's the realm of the Spirit. You're not bored. You're not bored when you're over in the realm of the glory and over in the realm of the Spirit. And this is a Spirit church. And people come in and they're just like, man, they're long. Get over in the realm of the Spirit. That's what we're trying to lead you to. The Father will always bring you to the water to drink. But will you drink? The choice is yours. He'll bring you to where that well is that will flow out in you and be a living water, and you'll never thirst again. He'll bring men there again and again, but will they drink? Many say no. Few say yes. But he'll keep trying to bring them to the water to drink. Will you choose to come and drink of the living water? The water that just totally makes time and your issues and your sorrow and your sadness go away. But will you drink? The choice is yours. Will you drink? Oh, praise you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Just one more scripture, and when we go into Romans chapter 8, we want to read the whole chapter. Oh, thank you, Jesus, because this is living and this is life. But we'll just skip down. You know, we can't skip down. We just have to go over this just real quick. And we'll just start at verse 4. We'll skip a little bit. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but the Spirit. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit mind the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally, fleshly minded is death. Death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is the enmity against God. It's the enemy of God. The fleshly mind, humanism, man's way of thinking is the enemy of God. It hooks up with the demonic realm. We see how fast Adam and Eve in all the glory and the splendor, without the knowledge of good and evil, in the presence of God, walking with God in the cool of the evening, the fellowship that they had with God, and how quickly their thinking, listening to the deception of the serpent, his beguiling words, how quickly they're rationalizing in their mind, well, it is good fruit and pleasant to the eye. It must taste good too. And the serpent says, we shall not surely die. She didn't believe God. She didn't believe God. She didn't believe God. She believed a lie instead. That's where the brain will get you. That's where your mind will get you. That's where your ability. We got to remember, we have the mind of Christ. We're hooking up with him. We're staying over here. We're not listening to Satan's beguiling things. We're not walking in this human fleshly life. But to be spiritually minded is life, light, joy, happiness, peace. It's all the realms of heaven, all the goodness. Because the carnal mind is the enemy against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. That's with the scripture I meant to read in Hebrews chapter 11. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Believe God. Must believe God. For without him, without believing God, it's impossible to please him. If you don't believe him, you can't please him. You got to believe him. And if you believe him, you're going to please him. So if you're not pleasing him, look and see where the belief problem is. Are you living over into your head and you figuring things out way too much and not living over in the realms of the Spirit? We belong to the Spirit. We're to live in the Spirit all the time. Because if we're not living in the Spirit, it comes right down here. We're none of his. But you are not in the flesh. But you are not in the flesh. The next verse right here takes care of it. But you are not in the flesh, but the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. He is none of his. So this is the realm that we live in. This is where we live. We live in the Spirit, and then we don't get in trouble. And we're not black on one side and white on the other. We live in the Spirit because he's given us the Spirit. We discern spiritual things because we are Spirit and life, because that's who he is. That's who he is on the inside of us. And we don't want to give ourselves to anything else but. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And this is the fulfillment of all the law right here in Romans chapter 13, verse 10. Love works no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. It's fulfilled in the fact of love. And it's number one, receiving the love of God that he has for us. Receiving and believing and knowing and having that confidence. And then when we have this confidence, we ask anything according to his will. He hears us. We know he hears us because we are bold and confident because daddy's standing right here behind us. Amen. And we ask anything according to his will. We want everything else that's a lie that tries to trick us and deceive us and hiss at us like that serpent did to Eve. We want it moved out of the way. We want to be aware of the enemy's devices that would try to turn our head at any time. And we want to be in tune with the Father by the Spirit, having the deep things of God revealed to us, living out this purpose. Hallelujah. Will everyone stand with me? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to your name. We praise you, Father, and we thank you. We thank you, Lord God, for what you do. And we thank you, Father, for impartation tonight. Father, I just thank you that your word goes deep down on the inside. Father, that we will not just be hearers, but we will be doers of the word. Father, we won't hear and then go away and be the same. But, Father, we will let the Spirit reveal to us the deep things of God, the things that you are speaking to us, Father, and we'll live it and we'll walk it out. We praise you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. We praise you, Father, for the Holy Ghost. You said go wait for the promise of the Father, and then where you'll be endued and you'll have power. And we thank you, Father, that we're endued with the Holy Ghost, and now we have power to be a witness, to live the life. It's living the life that's the greatest witness, not just opening your mouth and saying something, but living the life. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. If anybody in this place needs prayer for anything, I'll be glad to pray for you and everyone that wants to come and worship the Lord with what he's blessed you with. We want to give you an opportunity to do that at the same time. But I tell you what, Father's here to meet your need. And he's met so many people's need, because as the truth goes forth, if you grab it, you take it, and it becomes engrafted on the inside of you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for the rivers of living water. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. We thank you, Jesus.